It had been a warm fall that year in upstate New York. The leaves had slowly changed from green to the reds, oranges, and yellows that announced the inevitable march towards a cold, harsh winter. The people of Adamant Falls had begun to fill their porches with ghosts, goblins, and witches in preparation for Halloween. The real ghoul, however, was Patrick Malcolm, and the only treat he would be bringing to Molly was a cold death.
Midterms ended around mid-October that year because I remember it was a really warm fall, and that was why Patrick invited Molly up to his cottage. And she was so excited to go because it meant they would have some alone time.
After finishing his last exam, Patrick picked up Molly and drove the short distance to the Malcolms' country home. They had planned to spend the weekend walking in the forest, eating Mrs. Malcolm's home cooking, and simply enjoying each other's company.
Molly was having a really tough midterm schedule. She called me about halfway through and told me how grueling some of the tests had been. She was a smart girl. She could accomplish almost anything she tried. But I know one of her history courses was really tough. She really needed a break.
The weekend had begun well enough, but by the second day, events began to spiral down. A pleasant morning spent walking hand in hand in the forest quickly turned sour by afternoon when some of Patrick's friends from school showed up at the house. Like president's students changing their wardrobes at the start of a new season, Patrick changed as well. He began his usual routine of taunting Molly along with his friends, and by dinner time, Molly decided she had had enough. She made a quick call to her roommate to let her know she was coming home, and then informed Patrick of her plans.
When Molly called me, it was around supper time, and it really surprised me that she called because, you know, normally when Patrick would do something, she would just take it, and this time it seemed different, that she was actually standing up to him and coming home. I had rowing the next day, but I thought we'd get a chance to talk about it when she got back.
Patrick was shocked when Molly announced she was going back to school. After the two argued briefly in the driveway, Molly took his car keys and left for school. Patrick stormed to his room and, according to his friends, spent the entire night there. An alibi about as plausible as someone from a low-income family becoming student body president. Because by 5:30 a.m. the following morning, Molly had still not returned home.
I had spoken to Molly the night before, but when I woke up for practice, her bed hadn't been slept in, but I just figured that Patrick and Molly made up for the millionth time and he'd redeemed himself in some way, but I was so wrong.
The victim was found at 5:30 a.m. on October 23rd by a physical plant employee. We were contacted along with EMS and we did try to revive the victim. It appeared that she had sustained a blow to the head from a fall down the stairs. Unfortunately, this information was accidentally leaked to the family. Crime scene personnel from New York arrived and determined that it was not simply just a fall.
When the university called to tell me about Molly, I couldn't even breathe. To have someone just call you and tell you that your daughter's dead because she fell down some stairs. It was unbelievable. I was devastated. I wish no one would ever have to get a call like that. I wish no one would ever have to go through anything like that again. I wish I never had to go through it. She had such a bright future. She had such a bright future.
The theory of an accident was short-lived. Trace evidence found on Molly's clothing was genetically matched to Patrick Malcolm. Blood, originally thought to be Molly's, turned out to be his. Fibers from his sweater were found underneath her fingernails. This irrefutably placed Patrick not only at the scene of the crime, but showed his active involvement in Molly's demise, making Malcolm's alibi of having spent the entire night in his room shatter quicker than a toppling tower of empty beer bottles. Within 2 hours, state police had arrested Patrick Malcolm at his family home. The Malcolms responded by having their lawyer tape a brief statement in Patrick's defense, a statement which was virtually private, with only a handful of reporters invited and an edited tape version provided to media outlets.
After Patrick was arrested, I was asked by the family to appear at the home and insist that Patrick was innocent. Patrick Malcolm remained at home on the night in question, and upon hearing the news of Molly's death, was and still is deeply traumatized. I would ask that the police, reporters, and concerned citizens look at the facts. The facts will be what determine the truth in this case, and not lies or rumors. Let us look at the facts, and they alone will lead us to the truth.
When I got the news that they had arrested Patrick, I was so torn. My feelings were so torn. I wanted to jump for joy because they'd finally arrested that monster who took my baby's life. But then I'd remember something that Molly had done, something really cute, like when she was in the Christmas concert at school. And then I'd remember when she got the letter that told her she was accepted into President's. That joy of his arrest would turn into such a deep sadness. I knew eventually we would have justice. But that justice should never have been necessary in the first place. My daughter should never have died. My daughter did not deserve to die so young.